I feel like I'm walking in the dark. I'm in a challenging place. I'm wandering and wondering. I feel like I'm in a deep, dark hole. It feels like wilderness. I'm looking for direction, for light. These are just a few of the comments that some of you have made over the last few weeks. And we've all been on that journey at one time or another, haven't we? Walking in the shadows, walking in the darkness, living our life as if we don't know what the next day might bring. Today we hear the prophet Isaiah speaking to a community, the people of Israel, who felt like they were walking in darkness. They were living under oppression, under the boots, as the prophet says, of the tramping warriors. That darkness and despair had settled over the land of Israel, and it was disorienting. They had lost direction and hope. And to this community, to these people, Isaiah speaks the words that we heard read this morning, words of light and hope. You who are walking in darkness, God will give light. You who are living in a land of deep darkness, light is going to shine on you. You who feel the burden of oppression, God will lift that burden from you. So don't be afraid. Don't give up. God's light will break through our gloom and our anguish, and you will experience joy. We either see the prophets as crazy people, idealistic, or courageous. And I'm going to go with courageous. It takes courage to preach hope in the midst of such desolation. It takes courage to speak words of light and hope and newness of life and imagine a different kind of future when you feel as if you are weighed down by despair. And Isaiah keeps in front of the people a vision of the world when there will be justice and peace for all. Isaiah and the other prophets remind us of the power of imagination, that we need to imagine and see beyond things as they are and to imagine things as they may be. The prophets remind us not to settle and not to lower our sights and get comfortable in the oppression. The prophets remind us that we are not to get comfortable in accepting the oppression of those around us, or this despair, or to throw up our hands in the air and say, what can I possibly do to change anything? Epiphany is the season in the church year when we reflect on what it means to be a follower or a disciple of Jesus, to be the ones who are the incarnation of the light of Jesus that was incarnated at Christmas. When we celebrated Jesus' birth at Christmas, we celebrate the light of God coming into the world. But now those flickering candles of Christmas Eve have turned into a light for the whole world that you and I are to be sharing, embodying, and living out. The light of Christmas now fills the world and rests upon us as the people of Christ. And we know that all around us we hear voices that call us into that despair, that all around us there are voices that want us to go into the darkness rather into the light. There's all around us voices that are calling us to question what is the truth and what is right. And those voices cause us not only to question what we know, but even to question what we believe. And if we listen to those voices long enough, we get frustrated, maybe angry, or maybe we just pull ourselves into despair. But upon us, light has shined. That's what we celebrate as a community. That's what we believe, that on us, light has shined. And the light has come into the world in Jesus, and there is no amount of darkness and despair that can put it out. You and I are the ones who follow Jesus, who healed and teach, and who stood up against the oppressors. The Jesus who fed the hungry, the Jesus who healed, the Jesus who lived and died so that we might know what it means to have life here and forevermore. The Jesus who gives voice to those whose voices go unheard. And we are called to follow him, to join in that work of peace and justice, to take the time to pray and reflect and to listen to the voice of Jesus in our lives and not the other voices, so that we can create a community that is marked by compassion, inclusion, and love. So in these days, when our personal lives may be marked by challenge, and where we live in a world where it's difficult to know who is telling the truth, and we see people being treated as commodities, and where there's people sleeping on the streets and children being separated from their families at the border, where older members of our community are told they have no more worth, and children are jammed into classrooms, I see light. I really do. And it doesn't take long for me, if I pay attention, to see signs of God's light shining in the world, and I hope you will as well. I see the light of Christ shining when our church is willing to host event after event after event that call attention to issues that are troubling in our community and the world, whether it's immigration, gun control, poverty, LGBTQ+ rights, aging, voting. You need to know that there's other groups and organizations that say no to these events because they fear the consequences. They don't want to get involved. But we're a shining light in the community because they know this is a safe place where we can bring divergent opinions together and people to wrestle with these life issues. I see the light of Christ as I did last weekend at Franklinton Center, where we had 30-plus adults from our church and congregation, Colomy, who choose to take time from their families, even days off from work, to journey alongside teenagers and teach them how to install floor tiles and drop ceilings and drywall, learn how to use a broom or a rake and cook and clean. You know, when we were singing that third verse of the You've Come Down to the Lakeshore, you take my weary hands, and I was like, yeah, I think we're still feeling weary and tired, you know, from last weekend. But these are adults who are a shining light, and they're willing to listen and to share their lives with our young people. And Kim and I were just at a workshop this week about how do we in the church enhance our youth ministry programs. And we were kind of astounded that what others think is innovation, we've been doing forever, which is intergenerational. They made the point that teenagers need adults and adults need teenagers. And we were sitting there, duh, you know, but we see it. We see the power of all those different ages coming together and honoring the gifts that each of those generations brings to the life of the church. This week, one of our older members, age 98, Ethel Engelberger, died. She was very much a recluse. But when I went to talk to her family at the funeral on Friday, one of them said, she just got a card from the church again. I see light when members of our church send card after card to people they don't even know, just to let our older members know that they've not been forgotten. I see light when one of our teens sees a younger child kind of squirming or needing help with their homework or wants to play a game, and I see that teen reach out to them. That teenager has seen and noticed one of our kids. I see light when the Green Committee and Linda Coyle remind us to share the earth, to care for the earth, and the rest of us don't complain about bringing a refillable water bottle with us or washing the dishes. That's light. Because we all know it'd be a lot easier sometimes just to get the throwaway stuff. But we care for our earth, and we're part of that sharing the light in the world. And I see light and experience light When you teachers tell me about your students and the struggle you have to care for them in the systems that you work, when you tell me about your coworkers or your neighbors and the ways you're paying attention to the pain in their lives and you offer them encouragement and hope, I see light. Let's not take for granted each of those acts of kindness and love, each of those acts of justice and peace, because those actions of light start a ripple effect that can go all around the world. We are the bearers of Christ's light. We are the bearers of Christ's good news. And even when we feel like we're living in a wilderness or walking in darkness, God's light is shining on us and through us, ahead of us, calling us to a vision of what our world and what we can become, calling us to new ways of living and being. Thanks be to God. Amen. May we join our hearts in prayer.